How many know that prayer will prevail? Amen. That there is prevailing prayer if it's done like God wants it to do, and if you're, of course, moving with the Lord, because sometimes we pray things that are not necessarily what God wants, and when you pray something that's not what God wants, how many know it don't happen? It don't. So we've got to learn how to pray prevailing prayers, and that's kind of what I want to look at this morning, because he prayed a prevailing prayer and several prayers in the story, and even before this and afterwards, that showed that God truly was the Lord, that the Lord was God. So I think it's important this morning that we learn how to do that, that we learn how to prevail in prayer. So look with me in 1 Kings chapter 18. I'm going to be reading, start off with verse 1. It says, "And it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came to Elijah in the third year, saying, Go present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the earth." So catch this. There's been 3 years past now since Elijah first said to him in chapter 17, verse 1, "According to my word, there will be no rain." So for 3 years, there's not been a drop of rain in the entire land. It's a desperate time. There's a drought. There's a famine. It is a very difficult days. But now God sends his word back to the prophet saying, "All right, it's time for rain now. I want you to go speak to that evil king." And of course, God had some other things coming to pass with it. Look down in verse 20. So King Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. Elijah came to all the people and said, "How long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him, but if Baal, follow him." But the people answered him not a word. Then Elijah said to the people, "I alone am left a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Therefore, let us give us two bulls and let them choose one bull for themselves, cut it in pieces, lay it on the wood, and put no fire under it. And I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood and put no fire under it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God." So all the people answered and said, "It's well spoken." Or in other words, sounds like a good idea. All right. So look down and going down to verse 29, it says, "And when midday was past, they prophesied," meaning those 450 prophets of Baal, "until the time of the evening sacrifice, but there was no voice, no one answered, and no one paid attention." And if you actually read in between there, it says they worked themselves up to a frenzy. They cut themselves with knives. They danced, they hooped, they hollered. They did all they could do to get Baal to answer and send fire, and nothing happened. Elijah actually starts to taunt them. He said, "Well, maybe your God's on a trip. Maybe you need to talk a little louder. Maybe he's in the bathroom." Actually, it's kind of what it says and indicates there. "Maybe he's in the bathroom. You know, he's taking a break. You know, maybe you need to get his attention." So they do everything, and nothing happens. Then look at verse 30. "Elijah said to the people, Come near to me. So all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, Israel shall be your name. And then with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord and made a trench around the altar large enough to hold two seas of seed. Put the wood in order and cut the bull in pieces, laid it on the wood, and he said, Fill four water pots with water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. Then he said, Do it a second time, and they did it a second time. And he said, Do it a third time, and again they did it a third time. So the water ran down around the altar and also filled the trench with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that you are the Lord God and that you have turned their hearts back to you again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked it up with the water that was in the trench. And all the people saw it, fell on their faces and said, The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God." I mean, the God showed up and showed off. God showed up and showed off. That was prevailing prayer. Elijah had prayed and prevailed. Actually, God prevailed. But Elijah, because Elijah was speaking on behalf of God, declaring the word of the Lord, and Elijah had prayed, his prayers prevailed also. So I want to look at that this morning. Principles on prevailing prayer to see what we need to do in order to see the similar things take place in our lives. How many of you want to prevail in prayer this morning? Amen. Well, let's look at that. First thing that you're going to need to do is you need to do this. You need to perceive God's will, and you need to pursue it. If we're going to prevail in prayer, we've got to perceive what the will of the Lord is, and we've got to pursue God's will. Because if you don't know what God's will is, and if you don't then pursue the will of God, then you're not going to prevail in prayer because your prayers are going to bounce off the ceiling. They're going to bounce off the wall and hit you in the face. They're not going to go anywhere because you've got to know God's will. How many know that when you partner with the will of God, things happen? Because God's will is what needs to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's what prayer does. Prayer brings that down to earth. Prayer enforces that, releases that, if I could say it that way, in the earth. I found this cute little comic that I want to put up that I found is wonderful. This old lady is talking to this young girl with a cell phone. She said, "Wireless communication is nothing new. I've been praying for 75 years. How many know that before there were cell phones, before there were radios, before there was all the technology and the various social media, there was prayer. There was a way to communicate that transcended all other things. There was a way to, you know, get to where the Lord wanted you to be. So we need to understand these principles this morning, because prayer has been around for a long time, but you got to also know how to prevail in the prayer. So a couple things I want to bring out that are important along with this. First of all, we must be able to know God's will and pray accordingly. If we're going to pray in a way that prevails, you've got to know the will of God, and you got to pray according to God's will. And that's where we mess up quite often. How many of you confess that it's difficult sometimes to discern the will of the Lord? Not always sure what God wants. Or many times we know what God's will is, but we're not sure the timing. We don't know when God wants to do what it was. I mean, the word is pretty clear. There are some things that God says he wants to do. But also you have to keep in mind, God allows for the free will of man. He allows for us to be somehow involved in that process. So sometimes, even though God may want something, it will not happen because God allows man to make a choice in the matter. How many know the Bible says he wants all men to be saved and all men to come to repentance? But how many know the Bible also says not everybody's going to be saved? Not everybody's coming to repentance. Why? Because even though that's God's will, God allows man a free choice in that matter. And the same thing would, I believe, apply to other principles in life. So we've got to know God's will and pray accordingly. If you read in the opening chapter of 18, it says that the word of the Lord came to Elijah. And God spoke to him and said, "Now I'm going to send rain. Go speak to King Ahab again." In other words, because he received God's word, because he heard from the Lord, Elijah knew what God wanted. He knew the will of God. And so therefore he could pray accordingly and he could go do something that God had told him to do. How many know that prayer is a vital part of our lives, but unless we know how to pray, and by knowing how to pray, first of all, I mean you know God's will. You discern what the Lord wants. You know his desire. You know what he wants to accomplish. You know what he's impressing upon you that needs to be done. Well, when God moves upon your heart and you get this inclination, you get this revelation, you get this moving of the Spirit upon you that you kind of know that this is something that God wants done, guess what he wants you to do at that point? He wants you to pray about it. He wants you to take it before him and begin to pray about it, because you, it's your job, once you discern what God wants and what he's leading you to do and what he's impressing upon you, it's the church's job then to pray that down on the earth and then actually to act on it sometime. How many know that God wants you to act on what we're praying? So we have to discern God's will and learn for it, pray according to it, and then join along with it. Join with God's will, partner with God's will, and through prayer we partner with that. But you got to know it. And when you come to know God's will in the matter or in the situation, in the world, you begin to pray accordingly. There's another thing about perceiving God's will and pursuing it that is also important. How many know that we need to live submitted to the will of God? It does no good for you to know God's will unless you're also willing to live your life according to God's will. In other words, you've got to submit to the will of God. Now, I know that word submission has become a dirty word to Americans, because we are independent, stubborn, proud, arrogant people that like to vote and have it our way. Well, don't we? That pretty much describes the American psyche. But you know what? That is not according to what God's kingdom is set up. God's kingdom is, there's a king. And if a king rules, then you are the servants of the king, and you submit your lives to his will. And so we must learn to lay down our desires, our will, to do what God wants. But you know what I've come to discover in my life? As I submit my will to his will, I find that God's will is the best thing for my life. He has the best that's possible for me and his blessings. And even if I may suffer a little bit right here and now in this life, I know I have a reward that far surpasses anything that I would have gotten now. You got to also keep that eternal perspective going on. You may not always have everything you want the way you want it right here and now, but honey, God will richly reward you if you'll be faithful in the midst of what you're doing right now, because great will your reward be in heaven itself if you're his child. But you've got to submit to God's will. Someone once said this, freedom does not mean the absence of constraints or moral absolutes. Suppose a skydiver at 10,000 feet up in the air announces to the rest of the group, I'm not going to use a parachute chute this time. I want my freedom. Kind of stupid, isn't it? The fact is that a skydiver is constrained, even in his freedom, by a greater law. What is that law? The law of gravity. But when the skydiver chooses the constraint of using a parachute, guess what? He's free to experience the exhilaration of the jump and of gliding through the air gently to the earth instead of going splat like a bug on a windshield. Why? Because even in our freedom, we need to realize there are divine constraints built in. How do you know God has given mankind a free will right now? He allows man, when you're born, he gives you a choice. Serve me or not. It's your choice. In this life, you have a choice to serve God or not. But there is an overall law of constraint to that. And that law of constraints is this. If you choose not to serve me in this life, you will answer for it on the day of judgment and spend all of eternity in a burning place of torment. What do you want to do? He gives you that freedom of choice, but that freedom is for right now, because how many know the Bible says there's the coming a day when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Even the old devil himself is going to have to bow and confess that. God is going to enforce that. So we have freedom right now. Elijah went out to obey the Lord, and he met with his evil king, Ahab. He first, though, before he went to meet Ahab, if you actually read the whole story, that I just didn't have time to read, because it's a pretty long chapter. Ahab had a servant named Obadiah. Obadiah was actually a servant of the Lord, though. He lived for God. He served God. And Obadiah, when Ahab was going around killing all the prophets of the Lord and trying to kill Elijah, Obadiah did something that was at risk of his own life. He took and hid 100 prophets of God, of the true prophets. He hid them in a cave, and he fed them out of his own sustenance, out of his own treasury. He must have been a pretty wealthy guy. And these guys lived off of his generosity for years like this. And so Elijah goes and finds Obadiah, who is the servant of the king, and he tells him, he says, I want to meet with the king. Well, Obadiah's a little bit scared because he's not quite sure Elijah's going to show up for the appointment. You ever have somebody that you're just not sure always is going to make it to what they're supposed to? They're unreliable to show up at the appointment, always running late. Well, Obadiah was a little bit nervous because he realized if he tells the king Elijah's going to meet with him, and then Elijah don't show up, guess whose head's going to be chopped off? It's his. It's kind of like the queen, you know, Alice and Wonder, off with his head, you know. So he's a little nervous about this, and so he kind of talks to Elijah, and Elijah assures him. He says, I will show up, and I will be there. So he makes the appointment with King Ahab, because Ahab has issued orders, apparently, that Elijah's to be killed on sight. And so rather than trying to do that, which is foolish, he made the appointment, and Elijah does come. Elijah met with the king, this evil king Ahab, and he told him that now's come the time. But there was this little thing that Elijah had to do before all this. He had to submit to God's will, and Obadiah had to submit to what God's will was. They had to do what the Lord had wanted them to do. We have to understand that if we're going to pray and prevail in prayer, because also understand this, the New Testament tells us in the book of James that through the whole process, Elijah was a man of prayer. He was praying through this whole time. So even when the Lord told him it was going to rain, he was already praying for rain. He was already travailing in prayer in his own time with the Lord and praying in his heart, you know, Lord, send the rain, send the rain, and different ways or aspects. Matter of fact, that's how it all stopped, because he'd already prayed that it not rain. But now he knows God's about to let it loose. How many know that you've got to live your life submitted to God's will? If you're not submitted to the will of the Lord, your prayers will not prevail. Your prayers will not accomplish what God wants. There's a third thing about submitting, perceiving God's will and pursuing it that's also important that comes out of this story. We can speak in authority when we know and are in the will of God. When you know God's will and you are operating in the will of God, You can speak with spiritual authority. You can speak with boldness. And when I speak, I mean pray, because prayer is also more than just talking to the Lord and communing with Him. There's also a divine aspect of prayer where you begin to speak on behalf of God. And let me tell you something. When God speaks, things happen. But God will speak through you. So that's what I mean by speaking with authority, praying with spiritual authority. Elijah was able to challenge all the prophets of Baal. He had 450, and Elijah was the only one really there at that time of the Lord, but Baal had 450 big prophets that were doing their thing. Elijah challenged them to a good old-fashioned showdown at high noon, if I could say it that way. And so he comes up with this scenario. He says, let's each of us build an altar, and each of us sacrifice a bull on that altar, but don't put a fire to it. He said, we'll pray to our God, and whoever God shows up and lights the fire supernaturally, that is the real God, and we'll worship Him. So if Baal can do that, well, we'll all worship Baal. But if the Lord is the one that does that, then He's the true God. They thought that was all a good idea. Little did they know that their goose was going to be cooked. Now, that tells you something. They expected it would have happened. That means that their worship of Baal, even though it was idolatry, there was also real supernatural powers at work in their lives and in their idol worship. And it was witchcraft, there was paganism, there were demonic spirits, there were fallen angels at work. So they were accustomed to supernatural things happening. How many know that the Bible even describes that in the last days, during the tribulation period, that the Antichrist will be able to cause fire to come down from heaven to deceive the people into worshiping him? Well, the false prophet will. You see, so it is something that maybe they had seen something like that, but how do you know this was a different story now, because God was going to be the one that would answer and restrain and prohibit anything else from action. How do you know that the power of God is greater than the devil? No matter what Satan wants to try, God's power is greater, especially when it regards to the fact that the church and the people of God are praying. Elijah has been praying. How do you know that prayer stops the enemy? Prayer binds the enemy. Prayer prohibits him from doing what he wants, and prayer then paves the way and opens up the windows of heaven for the power of God to manifest and to do what God wants. But we have to speak with authority, and we can do so when we know God's will and we're in God's will. Elijah, went to all the day, and he mocked them as they were unable to get Baal to respond. And so finally, at the end of the turn, it was now his turn. And so Elijah makes the altar, puts the animal on the altar, puts the wood there first, and has them pour water over the thing several times to make it physically impossible for any man to start the fire. I mean, they didn't have, thermite and stuff like that at that point. So it's basically going to be a miracle or bust. But how do you know that's what Elijah was accustomed to? And so he steps back and he begins to pray something. Go on to the next slide there. I want to show you what Elijah prayed. What did Elijah pray? Well, first of all, he prayed that it would be known that the Lord was God in Israel. He said, God, I want you to know about what's about to happen, that you are the God of Israel, that you are known as the God of Israel. I want this to be such a powerful manifestation of your glory and your might that everybody that hears about it will say, the Lord, He is God, and He's God in Israel. How many know that we need to see God be God in America right now? We need to see God's power manifested, so we, the church, need to pray for that. He also prayed that God would let it be known that He was God's servant. See, his whole ministry was in doubt at this point. If God didn't show up, then they were going to kill him probably. So he also prayed to the Lord, and it's not a selfish thing to pray. He said, Lord, let everybody know that I am your man. I am your servant. I am truly preaching the truth and the word of God here. And so God, by this miracle, was going to validate his ministry. You see, people are not perfect. Matter of fact, after this story, Elijah, and I'm going to preach on it probably next week, he gets a little scared, and he kind of runs for his life and gets a little depressed and so forth. So, Elijah was not perfect, but he was still the man of God. He was still a servant of God. Aren't you glad that God uses us even in the midst of our weaknesses and faults and shortcomings many times? Now, sometimes you can make a serious mistake that hinders what God wants to do through us. But he wanted God to show that he was his servant. And then he also prayed that God would show them that he had been doing God's will. How many know that the devil wants to make us doubt whether we're in the will of God so many times or doing God's will? I mean, that's a hard thing. Can you imagine he's seen the people suffering for 3 years because he's prayed there be no rain and the drought has come and there's a famine and people are starving to death? How many know there's a man that had to affect him? as a man, as he sees even wicked people, you know, languishing in the throes of starvation and little children starving to death, that had to affect him. And so people were angry at him and mad at him and accusing him of being of the devil. Because how many know that when things go bad in people's life, they immediately say it's the devil? And even the spiritual people will blame and say it was the devil, but it wasn't the devil. It was a judgment act of God. And so through his prayer here of God showing up, he wanted everybody to know, I was doing God's will when I prayed that it be no rain. Because God wanted to bring that nation back to repentance. God wanted to bring that nation back to repentance. I know I'm speaking off the top of my head right now, but I can remember when that terrible hurricane Katrina hit New Orleans. How many of you remember that? It was interesting to sit back and watch the Christian television coverage, not the news media. I'm talking about the Christian, you know, people talking about it. You had one camp that was just saying how awful this was. It was the devil. It was this. And you had the other camp that stood back and said, you know, that city was pretty wicked. We believe it was a judgment of God. And I watched then the two of them begin to argue with each other. You can have your own opinion with that, but let me tell you something. It was a wicked city. It was a truly evil, wicked city. The depravity there was unparalleled in anywhere else in the nation, and it would not surprise me if God said, enough of this. Enough of this. Repent and humble yourself, or the whole nation's going to go this way. I would rather God humble us with an act of judgment to call us to repentance so that we get the point and turn to him and start living for him than everything like that happened. How many of you know that's the mercy of God? Unfortunately, they didn't get the message, because I remember at the cleanup, the mayor of the town basically told some people that were suggesting that maybe they should, you know, kind of tone down and, you know, seek the Lord. He said, hey, this is a party city. And he sent the whole police force out to Las Vegas and gave them money to gamble. And when the people challenged that and said, maybe that's not a good idea, we need those police to help, you know, keep, you know, order, he kind of got mad at him. He said, hey, this is a party city. If you don't like it, tough. Well, how many know that we need to do what's right and obey God? The other thing he prayed for is that God would hear him so he would know that, so they would know that the Lord was God. I already said that. And then he prayed for God to answer with fire so the people's hearts would be turned. He specifically said, Lord, answer with fire so the hearts of these people will turn to the Lord. And that's exactly what happened, because when the fire of God fell, whether it was a bolt of lightning or a little fireball came from heaven somehow, I don't know how God did. Maybe God had a big lighter and just lit it up right underneath the fire. I don't know how it does it. But anyway, that thing came alive with fire. And the fire was so great, it not only burned up the bull and the wood, it also consumed the stones. How many know it's got to be a pretty hot fire to consume stones? Took the water away, everything. And when the people saw it, they fell down on their faces and started saying, the Lord, he's God. And you know what Elijah did? He said, go get them prophets of Baal, catch every one of them, and kill them. Put an end to this wickedness. And they did. And a great revival began to break out and take place. How many know that we need to do what God wants? Amen. There's a second thing I want to look at this morning. Not only do we need to perceive God's will and pursue it, but you also got to persevere in prayer. See, if our prayers are going to prevail, then there's this idea of perseverance that has to come to bear. We have to persevere inside of our prayers. Because if we don't persevere inside of our prayers, it's not going to happen. One of the concerns of the devil has, I believe, is he wants to keep Christians from praying. Samuel Chadwick once said this, he fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless work, and prayerless religion. He laughs at our toil, mocks our wisdom, but he trembles when we pray. Charles Spurgeon, a famous pastor, once said this, I would rather teach one man to pray than 10 men to preach. And Andrew Murray once wrote this. He said, the man who mobilizes the Christian church to pray will make its greatest contribution to world evangelism in history. See, there is power in prayer, but there has to be persistence in prayer. We have to persevere inside of prayer. A couple things that are important about that. First of all, we must learn to pray through until we receive from God. We've got to learn to pray through, and I've mentioned this before, I think, last week, but that is a true statement. We've got to learn to pray through until we receive from God. Elijah began praying for rain because after this whole scenario is over with, he tells the evil king, he says, now, get down off of the mountain because it's going to rain. And so Ahab jumps in his chariot and goes riding off, and Elijah starts to pray for rain. But guess what? Nothing happens. So Elijah sends his servant to go look out over the ocean and says, what do you see? And he comes back and says, I ain't seen nothing. Elijah continues to pray. Six times he sends his servant, I believe the word of God says, to look out there. And he comes back and says, there ain't nothing. But then the seventh time he comes back and he says, well, there's a teeny tiny cloud about the size of a man's hand. It's just coming up over the horizon. And Elijah gets up and he says, hurry, we need to get down off the mountain. And so he begins to run, and there was a great outpouring of rain. But the thing I want to point out is Elijah had to persevere in that prayer in order to prevail. How many know that sometimes you got to pray more than one time? You got to keep knocking. You got to keep seeking, and you got to keep asking. So you have to persevere inside of prayer. And the principle is this: God gives us precious promises in Christ, but we have to seek the fulfillment of them and the reception of them if we want to experience many of those blessings. That's the perseverance of prayer. Elijah prayed, and then he actually looked for the answer. When you pray, do you look for God to do it? Jesus actually said that, believe that you receive it, and ye shall have. Do we actually believe that what we're praying for is going to take place? Elijah not only prayed, but he really believed it, and he actually sent his servant to look for the answer, and he was persistent in that fashion. So we've got to know God's will, or at least attempt to know God's will, but sometimes you're not going to fully know. So what do you do in that point? Pray anyway. Just pray anyway. You may not fully be convinced, but just pray, and pray expecting, and then believe God to begin to answer. One of our pastors named Mark Batterson, who pastors some large churches in Washington, D.C. area, he once wrote the following in the book called The Circle Maker. How many of you remember that? We actually did that here in our church a while back. He says, have you ever felt like God was doing miracles for everyone and their brother, but you seem to be the odd man out? Seems like God is keeping his promises to everyone but you. What do you do when you feel God has answered everyone's prayers but yours? You can give up or you can hang on. You can let go or pray through. You can get frustrated with God or you can choose to live unoffended. Jesus promises blessing if we are not offended when he does things for others. And if he does it for them, he might do it for us. I don't know why God does what he does, but I do know that 100% of the prayers I don't pray won't get answered. It's called the 100% rule. 100% of the prayers that you don't pray won't get answered. You might have to think that through for a few seconds to let the significance of that sink in. But have you know that when we pray, we can be persistent and persevere in our prayers, and that's how we can prevail. Second thing is this. We must overcome all hindrances to prayer. Have you ever tried to pray and there was a big hindrance? There was a hindrance and you knew you were praying in the will of God. You knew even God had showed you this, but there was this hindrance. Well, how many know that we've got to overcome those hindrances inside of prayers? Well, what are these hindrances that affect us? Well, first of all, sin in our lives will affect that. How many know that if there's sin in our life, if we're not living in obedience to God's will, there's sin, it will affect us. And sin in two aspects mainly that affect us, and there are many others, but how about selfishness? How many know that if there's selfishness in your life, it's going to affect your prayers because we have to give up ourselves and pray God's will be done. James even tells us that in James 4:3, you ask and you receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your own lusts. You're asking with the wrong motivation. You can ask for the right thing, but with the wrong heart and the wrong motivation, and that's why sometimes it doesn't come to pass. So we have to give that up. And then strife in our hearts. How many know that if we have strife and envy and bitterness and malice towards other people, it will block our prayers. It will be a hindrance. We have to overcome that by repentance. Second thing is the weakness of the flesh. How many know that Jesus once said when he was talking about prayer, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is kind of weak. You know, one of the best ways if you're having a night of insomnia is just to get down on your knees by your bed and start praying, or else just start praying right where you're laying in bed. I guarantee you, probably in about 5 minutes, you'll be counting some sheep. It's just something about prayer. As you begin to pray, the flesh is weak, and the flesh just doesn't want to do that. It'll just kind of drift on off, and Jesus had to come wake up his own disciples once when he asked them to pray with him there in the Garden of Gethsemane, but their eyes were so heavy, but we need to overcome the weakness of the flesh. Third thing is unbelief. How many know that we've got to overcome unbelief? Because our unbelief is the main hindrance. Matter of fact, Jesus was once ministering to a child, and the father, you know, the disciples couldn't deal with it, so Jesus came and he asked the father, do you believe? And the father said, I believe, but help my unbelief. He was honest. He said, God, I believe you can do it, but I'm struggling a little bit here. How many know that we need to be honest with the Lord and say, Lord, I believe, but help my doubts. Help my unbelief. Help me get over this. And God will help you overcome that own hindrance even within yourself. And then the other thing is this. Demonic interferences. How many know that there are times when there are demonic interferences? How many like my little sound bite there? Sometimes there are demonic interferences that hinder our prayers. One of the classic examples is in the book of Daniel, chapter 10. Go and read it sometimes. Daniel had been praying and fasting for quite a while, and God actually sent an angel with the answer. But that angel was hindered from coming to Daniel for 21 days. I wonder if Daniel intended to fast that long. I wonder if he just started this thing thinking, oh, this will be pretty good here. We'll fast a day. And then the next day, God didn't answer. So he said, well, I guess I better keep going with this. 21 days later. He's pretty hungry by now, I imagine. But finally, the angel comes through. You know what the angel said? He said, I couldn't get through because there was a principality, a fallen angel, a demonic host that the prince of Persia withstood me, hindered me, restrained me. And I couldn't get through until God sent someone else, another powerful angel that let me break free. How many know that there are demonic powers that sometimes interfere with our prayers, and you've got to learn to pray with spiritual authority, you've got to press through, and you've got to prevail. How many of you are glad there's victory in the name of Jesus? Victory in the name of Jesus. Well, I'm going to close this message with this final point. Not only do you need to perceive and pursue God's will and persevere in prayer, but thirdly, you've got to do this if you want to prevail in your prayers. You've got to prepare to receive. Are you ready for the answer? Are you prepared to receive what God wants to do? Have you prayed and done what you need to do? Are you submitted to God's will? But are you ready to receive what the Lord has? Are you ready and prepared to let God bless you with what he's going to do? Mark Batterson also said this, miracles are the byproduct of prayers that were prayed by you or for you. And that should be all the motivation that you need to pray. God is determined that certain expressions of his power will only be exercised in response to prayer. We have not because we ask not. The greatest tragedy in life, he said, is the prayers that go unanswered because they go unasked. Now, here's the good news. If you do pray, all bets are off. You can live with holy anticipation because you never know how or when or where God is going to answer. But I promise you this. He will answer. And his answers are not limited to your requests. We pray out of our ignorance, but God answers out of his omniscience. We pray out of our impotence, but God answers out of his omnipotence. Can you say amen to that? See, our God is not limited like we are. Our God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, but we are to still ask and we are to still pray. But are we prepared to receive the answer that God wants to give? Two things. First of all, you may be required to do something as an act of faith and obedience. As you're praying and you've prayed and done what you need to do in prayer, sometimes you need to realize God will lay upon your heart and tell you to do something as a simple act of faith, an act of obedience, and that is how you receive what God wants to do. That's how you prepare yourself to receive. Elijah told Ahab to get up, get down off the mountain and go eat because there was going to be some rain. Later on, Elijah had a servant named Elisha who replaced him eventually as prophet. You know what Elisha, told this man named Naaman once who had leprosy and how God wanted to heal him? Naaman was told by Elisha, the prophet, he said, go dip seven times in the Jordan River, and when you do that seven times, you'll be healed and your flesh shall be clean. And he was a little mad at first. He thought, well, there's a lot better rivers, around than Jordan. Are you serious? It's dirty, it's nasty, it's yucky. But his servants wisely talked him into doing it. They said to him, sometimes you got to appeal to people's pride. I don't know why, but men especially. They said, well, if he had asked you to do some great and mighty, powerful thing, wouldn't you have done it? And he said, well, sure. They said, well, why not just try this? And so he goes down in the river, and he ducks down seven times in that water, but the seventh time when he comes up, the Bible says his flesh was as smooth and clean as a baby's. A simple act of faith and obedience. How many know that if he had not done that, he would have not been healed? We have to obey what God says. Jesus once told a blind man, go wash his face and he would be healed. He did that several times, a simple act of obedience, simple thing that God told someone once to do. And if they did it, it would happen. Second thing is this. If you're going to prepare to receive, not only do you need to do what God may require you to do as an act of obedience, but your response can determine the degree to which the power of God operates. Now, that is something that blows my mind sometimes. But your response, how you react, how you prepare, what you do, will determine quite often the level to which God's power operates. Matthew 13, verse 58, Jesus, it says here that he did not many works there in his hometown because of their unbelief. That is the most mysterious scripture, I must admit, in the New Testament Gospels that I've read. The power that Jesus, the Son of God, who operated and did all these things, raised the dead, healed the sick, cast out devils, did mighty things. It says he could do very little there except heal a few sick folks because of the unbelief of the people. They limited him. They hindered what he could have done. In 2 Kings chapter 13, we read the story of Elisha the prophet again, who went and told the kings to do something that he needed victory over his enemy that was attacking him. And so Elisha the prophet told him, he said, get some bow and arrows. And so he got the bow and he got some arrows out and he said, shoot. And so the king shot an arrow out the window. And the prophet said, that is the arrow of deliverance of the Lord, that you're going to defeat God's enemies for the people of God and have victory over them. And then he told him to do one more thing. He said, now take some arrows. And he got some arrows that he had. And he said, now strike the ground with them. And so the king got some arrows and he did this little tap. Because he was, you have to read behind the story, he was a little embarrassed. He thought, this is the stupidest thing in the world. What if you shoot an arrow, tap dance with arrows? What are you talking about? And the prophet got mad at him. He said, look up. You should have struck the ground repeatedly with those arrows. Bang, 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 bang. He said, if you had done that, God would have totally annihilated and destroyed your enemies. But because you only tapped the ground three little times, you're going to get victory over them three times, and they're still going to remain, and they're going to mess with you later on, basically. But if you had simply done it with passion, how many of the God's looking for people that will be passionate in their prayers, that will be passionate in their obedience? He said, if you had struck the ground repeatedly, meaning with energy, with might, just dashed those arrows and smashed them there on the ground, he said, God would have obliterated your enemies, and they would have never troubled you again. But you're going to learn a lesson the hard way. Have you ever had to learn a lesson the hard way from the Lord? He did obey, but he didn't have his heart fully in it. See, there's the other key, getting back to that obedience thing. We need to prevail in our prayers, so understand that your response will determine that. God is looking for a people. He's looking for a church. He's looking for individuals that will pray, that will perceive his will, and they will pursue his will. He's looking for a people also that will persevere in those prayers, but they'll be prepared. Are we prepared for what we've been praying for? How many know that there's been a lot of people, even before us here in this church, that have prayed for years that the power of God would move, that our revival would be here, that God would transform this community and bring about a spiritual awakening here? There have been saints down through the decades, not only in this church, but in the whole county, that have prayed that. Well, we need to be ready for God to do that and persevere in it. And I want to encourage you in your own life. Let's see what God wants to do there and be open to it. Amen? Would you pray with me this morning?